Good evening. Thank you for attending. I'd like to share some thoughts tonight about the model minority stereotype, in particular about this book. I'm happy to announce there's actually a chapter contributor in the midst, Karen. Karen, what number is your chapter of the 11? Not to put you on the spot. 10? Okay, the 10th of 11 total chapters. So the price of the book is a high, but it's more for libraries. So don't go out and spend that money. Have your librarian do that. They have generous research budgets. They can buy books. So this book I'm going to talk to you about, and Anthony's nice introduction. I'd like to be known for the researcher who has, you know, committed his life to this work. Albeit I'm a young scholar, I don't imagine stopping what I'm doing at any time soon. So the model minority stereotype is something I think about daily, personally and professionally. So I think about, how did I come to this topic? Well, like any graduate student, you know, writing your dissertation and thinking about research possibilities for a dissertation is how I came to enjoy and find meaning in this work. It's very cathartic because, as a transracial adoptee, Korean, born in Seoul, South Korea, and coming to America and being raised by two white American, colorblind Americans, I need to preface that. Race was something that, you know, I observed early on growing up, right? How we don't talk about race in America and how we do talk about it. Something I shared in, you know, a TED talk, which I draw on Eduardo Bonilla Silva's work of how we talk nasty about blacks, but I said that how we talk about nasty about Asians without sounding racist. And so very much the model minority stereotype is not something that we as Asian Americans, and I'm using the backslash here, not hyphenated, drawing on Palumbo Lau's work, but we have a multiplicity of intersectional identities. We have Asian adoptees, we have Asian Americans, we have many people who just identify with the Asian diaspora. So it's very important that when tonight's remarks I say Asian Americans, that's what I'm thinking about. I'm talking about everyone inclusively. So when we think about the model minority stereotype, this is kind of an early project I did. I wanted to look at the number of articles or popular writings that included the model minority in the title, because titles are important. Anyone that's written an article, oftentimes the title of the article comes at the last, right? It's that last part. It's like, how do I capture the essence of this piece? And so if the model minority stereotype or model minority myth shows up in the title, well, to me that's clearly a indication it's of a central importance. And so when you look at the trend from the 1960s onwards, and I haven't done the 2010s, you see a general swing upward in the popularity in terms of scholars undertaking this work. Now this is articles and popular writing, so like the Times, Newsweek, etc. It's not inclusive of like dissertations and theses. Now I've did the same thing, and there's a continual popularity in this topic. So, you know, if it remains popular and still relevant today, that means a lot of work still needs to be done, right? So I wanted to start a project, and last year when I was here, I shared this, but I share it again. The Model Minority Stereotype Project is kind of like a one-stop shop for finding all of this literature. So it's a catalog of over 400 citations. So if you need anything, that's where you can go. Which I found out that my university changed the website, and now it's only accessible through intranet as opposed to internet. So my grad assistant right now is scrambling trying to find a hosting website so it can be accessible globally in terms of, you know. So I was disappointed when I found that out. So, you know, as a researcher, a lot of people use Google, right? And I was interested to know, looking at Google Trends. Google Trends kind of shows you interest over time. And here's a Google trend of model minority, just that term, right? And I'm gonna, you know, share the model minority stereotype, my thoughts about, I use the term model minority stereotype in lieu of model minority myth. I think myth is not as accurate. Sure, it's a myth, but stereotype, I think, is a stronger word. And today I'm gonna even go further with my current work, saying that there's another term we should start using, and I'd like to get credit for that. So, but when we look at the interest over time, right, there's dips, and here's some top titles, right? So Forbes had a story, Asians in America, what's holding back the model minority? That looked like in 2011. Huffington Post, the dangers of being a model minority. San Francisco Chronicle, no model minority, the alienation of Oakland's 1L go. And if you're not familiar with that, that was the gentleman, Korean gentleman, who was school shooting, I believe, at Oikos University. Indian Express, the model minority myth. Huffington Post again, don't want to be the model minority for the American dream. The un-hyphen model minority, Desi, queer, and undocumented in America. Huffington Post again, I am not a model minority. You know, if we were to broadcast and to, you know, look into the future, where will we be as in terms of this body of research? Will the interest continue to grow? So, right, if we go back to this slide here, 2020s, 2030s, is this just going to continue to grow, or is it going to stop? Will it become unnecessary? My speculation would be, right, I'm not a futurist, but it's going to continue to grow because its application can be treated, right, when we talk about globally, internationally, as well as here in the United States. I just mentioned Karen is here, and she's the 10th chapter contributor, but she's writing from, right, the perspective of Canada. And so when we think of Gordon Pond's seminal work and the importation of the stereotype northward up to Canada, and in Canada you have a different geopolitical context than you have in the States, as well as in Korea, China, what have you. I'd like to begin tonight by just sharing some thoughts. It's incredibly difficult when you're planning these lectures ahead of time, right? You give the abstract of your talk and things are bound to change, but I initially proposed that the chapter contributors share visually, textually, auditorily. I wanted them to maybe share video, but you know, in academia, everyone gets really busy. So I have a couple of folks who sent me some writing I want to share with you. And I thought that would be more meaningful than just sharing more about the book. So I'd like to begin by sharing some thoughts that Chausa Dang and Susan Klein shared. They're at Ohio State, and they're co-writers of the first chapter, which they titled, I Can't Afford for You to Flunk, Positive Asian Stereotypes and Supportive Communication for Asian College Students. Now, just so you know a little bit about the authors, I believe Susan Klein, well, she is a professor, and then Chausa is the first primary author, and she is a student. But I want to say Susan is Dr. Klein is in English, but it's interesting their piece. So while self-endorsing positive stereotypes such as high achievement and perseverance could be beneficial to Asian college students, pressures to fit all expectations of the Asian model minority myth could be psychologically damaging. The way we interact with our family and friends is influential in how we perceive ourselves and our ability to cope with life's stresses. Their chapter examines the way distinct types of endorsement of positive Asian stereotypes are related to the quality of family interactions, social support, and coping among 128 Asian college students. Results indicate that family satisfaction and parental perfectionism are positively related to the endorsement of Asian stereotypes at the group level, while family satisfaction, subjective social support, and highly person-centered messages are positively related to self-endorsed positive Asian stereotypes. Family satisfaction, social support, and highly person-centered messages predicted Asian students' ability to cope with their academic problems and stresses. So I asked the chapter contributors to share with you all today what led them to write their chapter. And this is what they said. And this is Chao Sa speaking here. During my undergrad studies at the Ohio State University, I co-chaired a student-led discussion group on contemporary issues that Asian American students face on a daily basis. A particularly interesting discussion that we had focused on parents. The conversations felt almost therapeutic for many of the students who voiced things like pressures from parents to excel in school and of fragmented relationships. I reached out to Dr. Klein because I had previously taken her course on persuasive communication, in which the topic of my final project was debunking the model minority myth. I was interested in further exploring the model minority myth and the possible role of communication, particularly from family. So I guess she's a communication studies English, Dr. Klein. I also asked the contributors to share with you today what contribution does their chapter make to fighting this insidious myth, right? This stereotype. And this is what they say. Our chapter shifts the focus of individual Asian American overachievement to a family perspective. By doing so, we strengthen the argument that Asian Americans are not inexplicably better apt to succeed, rather, but rather there are factors at play, such as supportive communication from family. The conversations between Asian parents and students featured in their chapter gives readers an inside look into how supportive and not so supportive, right, communication may shape student perceptions of themselves in terms of being a model minority. So, you know, in my research, it's really fascinating, right, because we have people like Amy Chua who are espousing like this tiger parenting style, right? But that's not really specific to Chinese parents per se, because I know a lot of tiger parents who are not Chinese, right? And we have to consider intersections with socioeconomic status and many other things globally. But I thought their chapter did a wonderful job of tackling something that really needs to be tackled, and that is communication. The great thing about editing projects is you get to make friends, become friends with scholars, right, who are at campuses. And Tanya Grace Velasquez is one of those. She's a dear friend of mine now, consider a comrade in this fight against hegemony. And Tanya's chapter was the fourth in the book. And hers was titled, From Model Minority to Angry Asian Man. The subtitle was Social Media, Racism, and Counter-Hegemonic Voices. In various social media formats, Asian Americans have posted angry and creative reactions to cyber racism. Her chapter discusses the benefits of using social media discourse analysis to teach students about the modern societal impact of the model minority stereotype and Asian Americans who resist it online. Methods and theories that support this interdisciplinary approach include racial identity development theory, racial formations, critical race theory, feminist perspectives, and culture-relevant pedagogy. As a result, students learn to deconstruct cultural productions that shape the socio-political meanings of Asian American identity while critically reflecting on their own experiences with the stereotype. The work discussed in this chapter is based on participatory action research principles to develop critical media literacy, foster counter-hegemonic stories, and promote social change that expands our knowledge, institutional support, and compassion for the divergent experiences of Asian Americans, particularly in college settings. It was interesting. Last week, my university hosted the third annual Critical Media Literacy Conference. And the keynote, Dr. Shirley Steinberg, a Canadian scholar who writes about a wide variety of topics, her keynote address talked about Islamophobia and a lot about Orientalism. And you, when we think about Edward Said's work on Orientalism, counter-hegemonic work, it's just right in square with, it squares nicely with Tanya's chapter. You know, when I asked Tanya, what led you to write this chapter, she said, "I'm fascinated by all aspects of U.S. race relations and the complex ways race manifests itself at the micro and macro levels. For example, Asians and Asian Americans have been situated in a unique position that poses problems for contemporary race relations." She cites, "Daily I observe the model minority stereotype in Orientalism expressed in my classroom by college students, both Asian and non-Asian alike." She's an adjunct professor at Washington State University. Sorry, lost my spot. And as a multiracial person herself, that's Tanya speaking, "I too am subject to racialized ideas about my Asian identity. So I have personal experience with the subject. The power of these racial representations challenges me to find creative and reflexive ways to address the issues with my students. Writing this chapter was a way for me to capture and reflect on such efforts to ensure I'm on the right course, working towards social justice. Also, I wrote the chapter to encourage educators to think and teach in interdisciplinary ways and inspire the use of social media as a relevant educational tool." You know, I asked her again, right, what contribution does your chapter make? Because, you know, a lot of times we can say, you know, peer-reviewed journal articles, yes, book chapters make contributions. So if there are any graduate students in the audience, you know, you should write book chapters. It's great to write book chapters. What contribution does your make? "My chapter discusses how to teach college students about the model minority stereotype from a critical race perspective, to disrupt the myth and then introduce the divergent realities of Asian and Asian American experiences. My hope is that students integrate the lesson plans into their overall analyses about U.S. race relations, past to present. I'd like to think this matters when my students move into their adult lives. That will include shaping policy and community engagement through their careers in fields from the social sciences." You know, she took my offer. I asked, not all took my offer, but I asked chapter contributors to share anything else they'd like to say about the model minority stereotype. And she says, "You know, a thought I didn't discuss in my paper, but I think it's worth noting. Hyper-invisibility and hegemony. I'd like to stress how prevalent and pervasive the stereotype remains in the United States culture today, even in spaces that are, quote-unquote, perceived to be liberatory for other racial minority groups, such as, you know, diverse research or diversity resource centers, liberal think tanks, educational policy and data collection, etc. Also, she wants to point out, we can't assume it's only white European Americans and or Asians themselves who subscribe to the stereotype. Many non-white, non-Asian individuals believe in and reinforce and reify the stereotype. In fact, I've observed in class and in my community relations, they are often shocked when faced with the myth-busting reality of the disparate lives of Asians in the U.S., right? That there's multiple actors here. Right? And it's not just white people, and it's not just Asian people. And even when we say Asian Americans, white, we have multiracial folks and hybrid identities. And so this work is very important to look through different angles and perspectives, right? Lastly, before I return to some of my original thoughts of the matter, Bita Zakiri, was the contributor of chapter 9, and it was great. You know, I'm psyched Karen's in the audience, and I was psyched last week at the Critical Media Literacy Conference because Bita came. She's a doc student at Indiana. She came to the conference and shared about this work. And her title in the book, her chapter is "A Double-Edged Sword, Side Effects of the Model Minority Stereotype on Asian Immigrants in the U.S." Her chapter is very fascinating. I mean, all the chapters are fascinating, but I'd like to share some specific highlights from her piece. "The model minority stereotype of Asian Americans creates a multitude of identity crises for Asian minorities. Asians who cannot meet the incredibly high standards set before them by such classifications face crises and end up either rebelling against their culture and the dominant white culture or wallowing in shame for their failure to meet said expectations," right? On a larger scale, the stereotype does not consider class or habitus and the forms of capital that this heterogeneous and diverse community possesses. This chapter provides a theoretical examination of the effects of the model minority stereotype on Asian immigrants, with a focus on West Asians. The chapter reveals economic and cultural inequities the model minority stereotype causes within immigrant communities and the larger U.S. society, demonstrating how the stereotyping operates as a subsystem of whiteness used to promote the inequitable ideology of achieving the American dream through hard work while bringing racism to the forefront. You know, as a social foundations of education professor, that's our primary objective, right, for teacher training, is understanding ideology and whiteness. And so that's why I really loved Bita's work, because it tackles this messy work, this messy, important work, right? I asked her what led to writing this piece, and she says, my transnational experiences as an Iranian woman have driven my interest in issues of social equity, at the center of which lie race, gender, culture, class, and socioeconomic status. She writes, the cultural and social pressure of doing well and exceeding expectations has been something that has weighed down on me my whole life. As an educator, though I feel motivated and encouraged to do well is essential in student performance, I also see excessive pressure and unrealistic expectations leading to downfall of students, both academically, emotionally, socially, right? Because it makes a dent in their self-worth and social position. Though the concept of model minority may seem to some to be a positive projection at first glance, it is in fact a deficit model that embodies many social inequities. And I think that is so important for us to understand. I mean, I know people in Asian American studies get it. I know probably many of us in the room here get it. But when we're not preaching to the choir or people who are even, you know, have a shred of interest in this work, it's important. Many of my students say, Dr. H, how can a positive stereotype be bad? You know, if I was a black person, I wouldn't want to be stereotyped as a, you know, as a bum and lazy. But you know, if you're going to be stereotyped as this superstar, then that's good, isn't it? Like, wait, you missed the whole point here. Let's start from, you know, square one. When did it originate? Why did it originate? Who benefits from it? Et cetera, right? I asked Bita again, like all the others, what contribution? And this is what she says. She says, my chapter provides an overview of historical applications of the model minority stereotype of East Asians in the U.S., expanding to South Asians, and West Asians in the more recent decades. In doing so, I aim to outline the many inequities caused by the application of the model minority concept that places Asians in contrast to other minorities positively and negatively throughout U.S. history. The chapter discusses the ideology, again important, ideology, of creating a model minority as a subsystem of whiteness, raising the notion that not only does the model minority compare minority performance with the aim of, once again, promoting racial supremacy of some groups over others, without regard for socio-cultural and economic context. But it also serves to place Asian ethnicities in a racial status that is lower compared to that of white European descent, right? That, you know, they can aspire to do well and reach the height where white dominant culture resides on the social hierarchy. And lastly, I think it's important to note, she says, furthermore, this chapter, her chapter, reveals racial categorization in the United States to be highly problematic, especially with respect to Asiatic races, highlighting that the database on which the theory of Asian model minority is constructed is fallible, since the populations recognized as Asians in the U.S. are not representative of all Asians. I'd like to return to kind of the beginning. I shared, you know, why was I interested, you know, K-12 as a student, certainly not, school was not my thing, right? Which might be common, right? It was boring. I was uninterested. I was a reluctant reader. I hated to read as a youngster. But, you know, in college, I began to like reading, and I was like, dang, you guys have been lying to me. Like, I'm learning the truth, right? Reading Ronald, you know, Takaki's History of Asian America, Betty Lee Sung's work and others, right? This like, dang, this is the history of Chinese immigration, you know, like, where are we in the picture? Where are our contributions? Where are we? And so in my current work with the Model Minority, I mentioned earlier this evening that I use Model Minority Stereotype, right? But I think that that is much better than Model Minority Myth. But I think that I'd like to start calling it Model Minority Sophistry, right? And sophistry is a reason or argument that sounds correct, but it's actually false. So, right, we can argue that Asian Americans are successful, they're nerds, they're intelligent, they're overtaking Harvard, but we know those are patently false. But the problem is, right, because of ideology, whiteness, institutional racism, all of that, it's so sexy and it fills a purpose. We know, right, oh, they're just doing well. Well, that argument sounds correct, and so many people buy into it, right? But it's actually false. So I think a Model Minority Sophistry is actually what we're describing here. Taranishi's work and many others, Benji Chang and others, they tackle this work too. But when we start thinking about Model Minority Sophistry, I think, right, another thing I'm considering a lot in my work is complicity. Because, right, it can be a form of capital in the sense of, like, where you at. In terms of, you might be an Asian American who can use that as kind of like an ethnic options. Like, yep, yeah, in this space you will behave this way and you will access certain resources. And then other times, right, you can put it away. And right, that's what honorary whiteness can afford people at times. And so I think it's very dangerous when we have Chinese Americans and others, Amy Chua's, right, writing and talking about this, like, right, that they are in fact a model minority, right? So it's not a roast on her and others, but it's something we need to be aware of. Another thing that I'm considering is model minority enthymeme, and complicity is something. This is a book that's forthcoming that we tackle this notion of complicity of Asians. But if we think about enthymemes, right? Model minority enthymemes include the following comments heard regularly in schools and mainstream middle class white professional society. Have you heard these? Right? Of course she will get into a top college. Her mother's Chinese. Or those sisters are going to ace the exam. They come from a Korean family. You know, the implied premise in the first statement is that all Chinese are top students because Chinese mothers parent in unique ways, right? Anyone watch Fresh Off the Boat? Right? I think we had to wait, what, two episodes and boom. The boys were sitting at Cattleman's Ranch getting schooled by mom, right? Chinese Saturday school. It's in full operation, right? So we have to understand that the mainstream media socializes and condition us this image, right? So we have to combat these hegemonic images. That aside, I do enjoy watching the show. You know, it's like, there, we got some Asian people up here. And lastly, right, the implied premise in the second comment is that all Korean families produce studious test takers. And so that's that double-edged sword, right? I mean, so, yeah, you could benefit maybe, say you're like, if we can quantify this, which I don't think we can, but say you're like, you shouldn't be up in the top, but okay, you get the benefit of the doubt because you're Asian, okay, there it helps you. But what happens if you actually could use special ed or you could use language services and it's assumed, right, you don't need them? Well, that's, you know, it can cut both ways. And so I think there's a real danger, right, of a single story. That's why as Asians, Asian Americans, as allies, we need to write multiple stories and share our stories. Because our stories, right, you know, even Fresh Off the Boat, some people will say, you know, how can you stand up there and say you like that, but we need to be down with it and throw it out the window, right? People are going to disagree with me, but it's important that we make our stories available and then we can start having these conversations. So those are kind of some of my questions. I was reminded last week, last week, when I was in Texas, and the gentleman gave me a ride, he said, you know, it must be an honor, you know, you get to go and share your thoughts about this, you know, that's such an honor, and it absolutely is. So I'm honored to be here, and I take this work seriously, but I would love to engage in a conversation, because truth be told, I learn more from folks that come to the talks than actually the person that's doing the talking. So I've spoken enough. I'd like to kind of invite you to push back on anything I've said, ask for a clarification when I wasn't clear, and then we can wrap it up, because I know it's Friday and you might want to beat the rain. No, but thank you for coming. Are there any thoughts about anything I've said? Yeah.
So you're planning to try to change the actual vocabulary around model minority stereotype, model minority myth, all of that. And that's great for academia, right? Where we
Absolutely.
Are looking for words to encompass more than we can say in a paragraph.
Absolutely.
But sometimes, well, most of the time, actually, the people you want to reach is not necessarily academia, because they're the choir, right? Mm-hmm. You might be preaching to the choir. The ones that you want to reach are the people who are not going to know what sophistry is, are not going to know what entomeme is, all of these things. How do you think that you might want to actually tackle translating that, interpreting that in a way that can be a little bit more mass consumable but understood as well? Just because you can throw a word out there and maybe change the landscape, it's not reaching what I think are the people who really need to be reached.
Absolutely. I think about that daily, right? Because it's that combat of like earning tenure and doing what the institutions want you to do, but then actually using the institution for the community, which I believe, right, to change. So one thing I do is actually where I write. So I write a column for Korean adoptees, for instance, with Korean Quarterly. And so many times, you know, you write a very accessible, actually even plain language, below, like even easier to read than a newspaper, and you get emails like, hey, I read and this is so important and thank you, and then we start a dialogue. So that's one place, right? Because you're absolutely right, writing for an audience beyond the ivory tower. Second is just community work and with schools and what have you. So I do a lot of work in Chicago. But that's something, I mean, does anyone in the audience have, you know, beyond our writing? I mean, what are you guys doing here in NYC and in the broader metro area to advocate for Asian American issues? Or even in Canada, Karen? Yeah.
Yeah, I first thank you for the talk. I just want to say that I agree with your comment about you say non-whites and non-Asians have a stereotype. I tell you, I had lunch today with an African-American investment banker who was complaining that his $1 million bonus was insignificant. And I just told him, you're just so out of touch, that, you know, the average African-American income is $29,000 in New York City, and you're whining, those are not the words I use, but and I really enjoyed having lunch in the St. Regis, so, you know, so it was nice. I don't earn anywhere near his income. I have to say, as an African American and a Latino, I don't feel really much sympathy for mm-hmm. you. And I say this, I remember all the way from college being in a meeting, very political, and having a meeting about how we were going to win this student government election. And we were talking about themes, and the theme was honesty. We said the clubs control student government elections, and we have an issue of corruption among student leaders. We need honesty. And I said, let's get an Asian student. Let's put the Asian student as a treasurer. They never vote. There's 10% of them in the school. I went to CUNY. There's 10% of them in the school. We would have the edge. We put her in there. We sat down. She said, I don't think I'm going to win. I said, no, you can win. This is what you do. I gave her a book. She wrote notes. She did everything, da, 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 da. We didn't expect her to win. Anyway, she won because she did everything I told her. But she was studious and hardworking. She won. The next stereotype moving along is when I got to girlfriend at Cornell Law School, black girl, walking through the gorge, and I looked down and said, oh my God, that's scary. She said, oh yes, man, Asian student will jump if they get an A-. And so further my evolving stereotype, and then the next was when I got married and I had to find a childcare center for my son. There was one around the corner, very convenient, The majority of the students were African American Hispanics. And I asked my ex-wife, my wife at the time, I said, could you see if there's any other options? She found one in Koreatown at a lower price. And I said, we're going to take that. And I said, because I can confident that they're not going to hug my little boy and say he's adorable and he's poor and black and therefore he's not going to succeed. They're not going to be, you know, they're not going to hug him. They're going to put their foot up his ass and make him do well in school.
Mm-hmm.
And we put him in there, and the woman wasn't playing. She was, she didn't care he was black. And my son scores 4 out of 4 on all his statewide exams today at 9 years old. The last thing I'll say is that when I went looking for a roommate, Columbia graduate student, I wanted a roommate that that was focused on studying, had no friends come over, no girlfriends, no drugs, and felt pressured about their behavior and considerate to other people's feelings. Got a nice Singapore guy, he pays his rent. Now, he doesn't pay his rent on time, he pays it early.
Of course, right? So his credit score is off the roof, you know? He's just,
so,
yeah.
I just want to end by saying that, you know, when you, the only stereotype that African Americans, and actually only the men, there's only one stereotype that African men that we will loudly play up is the sexual one. That's the only one.
Yeah.
All the others that we're lazy, we're crooks, we get in an elevator, even if I'm wearing a suit, you know, white woman will grab her purse.
Mm.
And sometimes when I'm going to white events, I'll wear a pink shirt or pastels because it makes white people feel comfortable when they see a brother, you know, wearing certain colors. So that's
and you know, and right, and those we have to understand too, that stereotype, because right, no group is immune from stereotyping. Stereotypes are all across, right? But it's interesting, right, when we think about racial dynamics in the U.S., at least from my perspective, with racial triangulation and in America, white and black binaries, you know, even the eugenics research in the as late as you know, in the 90s, that looked at exactly what you said, the manhood of black males and intelligence scores, and then in the manhood of Asian men and their intelligence scores. And then, so how even the scholarly pseudoscientific research left academia, and then it entered into Family Guy and cultural spaces where it's consumed, right? And so to me, it's not just an issue, and that's where hegemony comes in. It's not just an issue of a stereotype, and then the counter narrative per se is the opposite, right? So we have film that portray Asians doing non-stereotypical behaviors, but that in effect is, you know, problematic and essentializing. So all of this work is complex. Thank you for your comments of that. Is there, what other work? Because that was the original question is, how do we do this work? And I have a visitor. Okay, I'll share it. He'll come this way. Yeah.
So, I mean, I kind of grew up in the Asian American Studies sort of like area. I majored in it in college and sort of come from that field. And so I've been working like 15 years now. And one of the issues that I've been sort of working in New York City is sort of the specialized high schools. And I think by telling the story, if I'm allowed to, I can get to the question.
Absolutely.
So, you know, the specialized high schools, which you take a test to get into in New York City, are heavily Asian American.
Mm.
Particularly the ones that are the hardest to get into.
70%.
Right, that's what I was saying. Right. And then about, you know, 60% of political science, and then about 50% of political tech. And so, you know, as an alum of one of those schools, I was really interested in sort of the arguments that were being put into, because the NAACP Legal Defense Fund filed a complaint in 2002 saying there's a disparate impact, and therefore, you know, there was discrimination that sort of led to these disparities in the schools. And coming from that area, you know, like, we got to stick together, you know, don't let model minority get into it, you know, mm-hmm. we got to stick together with these groups. And there are all these Asian American groups that supported the Legal Defense Fund. And I found myself personally troubled by that because I thought, well, there are some things that I'm uncomfortable with the arguments because I'm not sure if this is a system here, even though I think that there is a lot of racism and it's institutional and structural and probably can never go away, you know, but I mean, I get all that. I buy all that. I believe that. I work for the EEOC,
mm-hmm.
you know, so as I started wrestling with that question, I thought, you know, I'm hearing from people on the left going, model minority, we have to stick together with other, you know, ethnic groups. We can't let that sort of fight divide us. let the wedge issue
Come
in there. And I thought, well, Asian Americans have a certain sort of different issue here. Are we allowed to stand apart and to make arguments that benefit us only? You know, and if so, is that terrible to do? Or do we still need to ride along in the group and not let that be a wedge? So
what was the complaint? Who filed the complaint? Was it a white group or a black group?
Well, the LDF, Legal Defense Fund of the ACP, so it's essentially African Americans sort of led the fight for civil rights.
And they were saying that because of the high percentage that Asian success, that it was forming...
Well, I mean, they weren't saying that because that would be problematic.
Sure.
They're just saying that because of the numbers,
yeah.
There's a disparate impact, so we're saying there's discrimination. So that's the sort of legal argument. But, you know, unsaid is that I don't think they have a problem with, you know, sort of Asian Americans in the school, but and neither do I think it's healthy to have 75% Asian Americans in a school.
So I'm kind of
floating in between. But I'm having trouble responding to Asian Americans from the left, who are generally the social progressives who are there, saying, "Model minority, man, you got to stick with the, you got to stick with it. We can't move. We can't sort of come away." And I'm thinking, well, okay, political pluralism. Don't we have a political voice to advocate solely for our interests, so to speak? Is that too selfish politically? Is it sort of, you know, socially not something we should do? And that's kind of like I've been wrestling with that for the last couple of years, just very honestly, you know, knowing full well sort of Asian Americans, where we come in, you know, the heritage and the debt we have to the civil rights movement, sort of the fight against racism, but it's just really complicated. So.
Yeah, I mean, I think one, right, it's all along this lines. I mean, I'm a firm believer. I've benefited from affirmative action. Affirmative action is right, and you're absolutely right, trying to this wedge politicking. You know, I see that even with the issues right now going on with the anti-black violence, police brutality, and, you know, Asians, all Black Lives Matter, and Asians for Black Lives. We have to really wrestle with the understanding of whiteness and white supremacy in this country.
That's what Phil said in the discussion. I think the, you know, and that's what's missing from public discourse.
Absolutely.
Right. So
absolutely.
Except in academic circles, you know, which is, you know, people can understand and talk about it, but in general, sort of, you know, people don't talk about it.
Yeah, right, because it's fascinating because, right, that's the double edge. You're so successful, but then it can be used a tool against you, right? You're overly successful, now you're a threat. Now it's displacement, right? White displacement, white victimhood, right? But that really is not going on right here. You know, things shift, but...
Yeah, I just want to... first, I want to support you and to say is that the issue among the schools, we think that's a Trojan horse. Many African Americans, particularly the professional class, believe that the people that are truly angry at the success of Asians inside us and out of are white parents, and they're using African Americans because they are the ones that fund those groups. They're the ones that have the agenda. It's almost like the Upper East Side parents complaining about the sewage treatment plant because it's one block away from the housing projects, when they really care about their real estate interests, which is on 95th Street.
Thank you.
So,
thank you.
And as an African American, I can tell you, I find this argument extremely offensive because the argument is that we need to dummy down the test so that black kids can get in. Mm-hmm. And I think Obama was very good at what he said, you know, turn off the TV and read
mm-hmm.
to your kid.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and mm-hmm. Jesse Jackson commented it on Mike that, you know, the other side. And the reality is that African Americans and other ethnic groups that need to embrace education from early on, you know, and that has to become cultural. And until they do that, it's a race. Race, R-A-C-E, is a race. The reason why Asians are doing so well is because they practice group economics. They haven't gotten to group politics yet, but they practice group economics, and they mainly marry into their groups. The Asian woman is the top woman in the marriage and dating scene in America. The Asian man's on the bottom. And because white men will come and take your women. And black women are on the bottom in terms of marriage and dating. So those are that's the core of the dynamics in terms in New York City. But I find the point that you're making is I don't believe that's something that's constant among black women. We don't want you dummy down the test. The only reason why Asians do so well on this test is because the parents start them off from first grade, and that it's a race. And unless you're willing to do the same thing, you will never catch up to Asian kids. And that is the reality.
And
if we want black kids in Stuyvesant, then the argument should not be to dummy down the test. The argument should be to put the resources into giving poor families the ability to take prep courses from early on so that they can achieve on the same level, because no one is putting a gun and keeping black kids out of Stuyvesant.
Yeah.
I'm Betty Lee.
Yeah, absolutely. I know who you are, absolutely.
I was listening, I have hard hearing.
Sure.
But one thing is about the model minority myth is it's true. Everybody says good things about you.
Mm-hmm.
And how do you deny it and how do you deal with it?
Yeah, can I answer? I want to answer her question, but before I want to also, I mean, I agree with some of what you're saying also, but I think we have to, that goes back to this whole white supremacy, because now the Asian and black, now you're quarreling, squabbling. We have to also consider the state apparatus, wants to, and immigration, so that has set up, right, of who are we talking about here. If you look at the data, and Taranishi and others, the statisticians, do a nice job of showing the bimodal distribution of Asians, that they're not all high achieving, and also some of the testing you're citing, these high test scores, have some of the highest standard deviations and spread of scores. And so while it might appear a lot are above the mean, they're also widespread and very low quartile scores. So I think absolutely we need to consider that.
The numbers are, I'm not talking about test scores.
Sure.
The bodies are 70% Stuyvesant Asian.
Sure.
And not just Asian in terms of China, but also Indian. And
yeah.
If you look at America, there's two governors in the United States that are Asian and that are Indian.
Absolutely.
Black Americans make up like almost 14% of the population. Asians make up maybe two.
Sure.
We have two governors. Why? Because white people perceive Asians as a minority, and they're willing to accept them in the electorate.
I know the governor's hall, state houses, legislature is different than academia. But let me give you a counter thought. In some of my current research, looking at endowed chairs of education professors of Asians, there's only 8 in the U.S. You look at how many blacks. I don't even know off the top of my hundreds doing, and the percentage are just disparate, right? So you're absolutely right. I mean, I see that going on, but I think it's more complex than just this really straight linear. This is what's going on. I think there's a lot of powers to be that are using, right? Mari Matsuda talked about we will not be used for white supremacy. So Asians and blacks, Latinos, we need to start talking and about our common issues. But can I respond? Because that's a profound question. And I've had more senior mentors, Asian American mentors, talk to me about this at length, and really has pushed my thoughts forward, right? And I think rather than just saying what we aren't, we have to start just being and start asserting our stories. I shared, we have to share our stories. So while it's important to say, no, we're not model minorities, it's very important that we document our history and share our lives in, comedy and acting and different spaces and in politics, in schools, in the community, to really be versatile. And I know that's troubling. I know a lot of people want to do that work. But I think that's the best way to combat, right, like you said, how do we deny it, is just becoming who we are meant to be. And I think that's one way to start, because I know we have limited amount. So, I mean, that's my thought. What about you? Because you're wiser than I and experienced.
Well,
what are your thoughts?
Well, I agree with this gentleman that, the way we are brought up, we can't watch television. We can't have
sleepover
parties. We can't do this. We can't do this. Everything has to be all A's.
All A's.
Otherwise, you get hit. And so it's the parenting, which is very important.
Mm-hmm.
But I was curious as to why, how you deal with minority, model minority expressions, because you can't go and deny that you are good.
So let me give you an example personally. You know, as an adoptee going through school, I was racialized as, right, you're immediately, okay, you're Asian, what are you? I mean, even New York, I'm asked, Chinese? I'm like, no, Korean. But, right, so my parents definitely did not raise me how you're describing. In fact, you know, I did very lousy in school, and so I wasn't there. And there are a lot, Asian adoptees are a growing population. I mentor graduate students who do research, dissertation research, theses on this topic, right, as transracial adoptees. So I think we need to broaden the category. Who are we talking about? Asian Americans, adoptees, hybrid identities, and how do they make sense of the stereotype that is placed onto them, right? And so for me, you know, I speak Spanish and I'm learning Korean. I know, right? So I'm very odd when someone starts talking to me in Korean and I say I can't speak. That puts me as more in this liminal position of, well, am I authentically Asian? What are you? And so I think we need to start considering it more holistically and comprehensively than just rather, okay, you know, it's you're socialized this way because, you know, I'm Asian. I'm Asian American. But I come to this discussion from a different positionality.
Well, so bringing that up then, and you say fresh off the boat, it's important to share the story, but don't you feel like that does more damage than good by kind of reinforcing stereotypes, even though they are sharing an Asian American story?
There's a good documentary, Slanted Screen. It's on Netflix. I encourage you to look at that. That was a documentary. A lot of Asian American actors, males, and specifically talked about, you know, you're damaging our reputation. You know, you're just doing these Bruce Lee kung fu movies. And one actor, the name escapes me, but he was a Mortal Kombat actor, and he said, you know what, I think I'm helping, you know, and rather than, you know, I think we could, this paralysis of analysis, I think if we're striving, moving forward, we're going to make mistakes, but two steps forward, maybe some more back, but I think, no, I think if the effort is there, now, if the question is, does fresh off the boat help or hurt, I can't answer that question, but in terms of Asian presence, the more present we are, we're the fastest growing population, we need to be present.
Because I guess I'm a little worried that people who don't have enough Asian interaction could watch the show and then get their stereotypes that way.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
So that's why I feel like it does some type of damage as well.
But you know, mm-hmm. the fact that we are on the television screen
it's big. Yeah.
Is the way in,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
We used to be there.
right?
Yeah, yeah.
You start with, you have to take the bad with the good. You start with that. Then you tell the stories. You tell the broader categories. You show the diaspora. You show it in a more full-figured kind of instance. Then we can start breaking down, oh, hey, that's what, you have to give it time. It's not an instantaneous thing. It's not something that, you know.
And the mm-hmm. show has actually a very subversive voice.
Yes.
It does. It does have subversive.
So, yes, people might not notice it, but, you know, yeah. the ideas, I mean, you know, Jeff Kang is the father of the actor, so we've got Mr. Asian America there, right? You know, so, mm-hmm. you know, it's a very subversive take on Asian America, and my Asian American friends, who didn't care about this kind of stuff, they love it. They love it because it's like, they talk about a mom's perm and this. So,
yeah, you know, I remember that episode.
The stories are there told through a very Asian American lens that was not previously communicated.
Exactly. Yeah. And then there's another slant, if you will, mm-hmm. on that, is that it talks to outsiders, right? It's the outsiders telling the story. It's not
as
just
the insider looking at them.
Exactly.
So that's a subversiveness.
Yeah.
And when it pisses off the white people, it's like, we're really pissed about our, you know, depictions here.
Yeah, but it's not just speaking to the Asian American.
You know, because it's turning around these conventions to it's the lens upon which you're looking at the world. So
I guess I'm worried because I do I'm a teacher, so I do show things like that in my class, and I'm worried kids often miss that kind of.
I'm sure they do.
But that's where the critical media literacy comes in,
right,
and you can use it.
And that's what I'm worried about, because then they just see that, they're like the but they don't read between the lines, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me give you
our charge to help them see it a little bit.
Yeah. Give that to him. So that's yours. Just take a look and you can look at it. There's because the critical media piece, you'll benefit from that. So definitely take that. Yeah.
I just want to say April 17th, CUNY is hosting a panel forum on this issue.
Absolutely.
CUNY has been good enough, and I've been sort of holding panels and Flushing last year on this through the Asian American Bar Association and CALCA, the Korean American League for Civic Action.
Okay.
So that's kind of an answer to your question before.
Yeah. Absolutely. That's amazing. Any other thoughts?
Yeah, I had a question that sort of piggybacks off of Professor Sung's question. And that is, how do you dispel the stereotype or the sophistry of Asian Americans as a successful group generally, without constantly citing the least privileged amongst us? It's almost it almost seems a bit exploitative because these conversations sort of take place at the academic level or the political level. Usually comprised of the most educated of Asian Americans, having a conversation or strategizing ways to dispel the myth or the stereotype or sophistry by citing the least privileged of Asian Americans, those who are less socioeconomically advantaged, immigrants, recent immigrants, undocumented. How do you have the conversation, or how do you strategize to dispel the myth without constantly citing the least advantage? Because to me, it seems kind of exploitative.
Yeah, it is if you're doing it trying to, here's the argument, you counter-narrate the argument, counter-fact. I mean, if you talk about white supremacy, that's how I start, like, period. That's where we're starting, and then we'll branch out. When did the myth start? Why did it start? How did the state benefit from it? How does the state currently benefit? So we know those answers. 1966, year before 1965, Moynihan Report comes out demonizing black people for having a culture of poverty. And then we needed a sexy story to sell to the mainstream public. 66, who do we pick? Japanese. You know, the Peterson was a Berkeley sociologist, had no clue of what he was writing about. He said it, right? You read, Daryl Hamamoto's book, Monitored Peril, he cites that, talks about how he was commissioned to write the essay, didn't feel he had the expertise, but did nonetheless. And the point, right, then going forward, how has the myth continued to self-replicate and, right, become essentially a chimera that we can't cut the head off, right? That's how I think, because then, and also centralizing narrative, the humanity of people. And so for this other book that's coming out, I've done with the Killian model, we have, you know, Southeast Asian educators share their narrative. Women teachers talking about their life as teachers. I think that definitely is not deficit, and having them narrate it. So again, stories are so important. The question, I think, goes back to this, like, how do we get those stories out there? And that's where, I mean, I think social media is important also. And writing in areas that can be accessible, but then also going to where people are and share things in non-traditional ways. Newspapers, community newspapers, and languages beyond, right, English. Having translators and all of that, I mean, and community events. But that's a great question. That's how I do it. I, if you start with white supremacy and talking about that, I don't think that's deficit at all.
Yeah. I just have an observation. I think I can't speak for the rest of the country, but in New York City, we're so racially, we live in such racially segregated neighborhoods.
Yeah.
If you want to talk about poverty, just go to some obvious places. Walk down Lower Manhattan. I see so many people, elderly, seniors, going through the trash on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm.
It is willful blindness, I believe.
Absolutely.
To ignore that. Go you on the fringes of Chinatown, walk through the street in the summer, go into certain areas of maybe East Harlem, or go to areas of Brownsville. I'm just saying, go. It exists, but we live in a such a narrow way we go to work, we go to places that we're familiar with, right? And then we network and make friends within a certain socioeconomic group. We don't leave certain neighborhoods. So we are blind to these things. So stereotypes are, you know, takes a firm a hold. But those things are all open to us. It's whether we want to see it. I mean, there are people, I mean, I can see people who go, I work with people who, I don't know, there's this blinder on.
But do you think what you're describing, that phenomenon, is specific to New York? Because the invisible are blind in my city, and right, and people don't see them. They choose not to see them. Select. I mean, do you think de Blasio, has he done, have you seen, I'm not a New Yorker, has there been progress in that front in terms of social, you know, social welfare programming and poverty, or?
I just want to say that I want to agree absolutely with you. The face of poverty in New York City is the black female with the two out of wedlock kids. But if you go to East Harlem, or you go into Harlem, you go to the food pantries, you will see 20 to 25%, because I volunteer the food, are Asian.
Okay.
Online getting free food.
Okay.
And and if you see who's collecting the cans out of the bottles, you'll see that there are two groups, Mexicans or Latin Americans and Asian women. But they're not
the face
of poverty,
yeah,
in New York City. I don't see the woman. That's a very good question, and my answer to you would have been, how can you? And I said, it's seductive. You can't give it up. It's, you're being crowned by white supremacy with the number two position, and it's seductive. And I have to tell you, if when I was in my 20s, if I went to a party and some white woman or Asian woman said, oh, I want him, he's cute, and you know what the stereotype with him is, I would never say it wasn't true. I would play it to the hill. It's seductive. Why? You would never give it up. You know, if you're in a waiting room of a human resource, and there's a black candidate, Asian candidate, and white candidate, and it's a finance job, you know, good luck for the black kid.
So, I mean, is it that simplistic, though? Like, now we have Jeremy Lin, now is it this, now we're not just academic model minorities, now we're athletic? Do you think now...
You guys are so good. I bet you they think you got all A's in school.
Oh, at Harvard while I was playing college?
And of course he's good at basketball, because yeah, it's only a natural transgression in terms of, you know, I mean, I'm in real estate, I'm an asset manager. 50% of the money coming into this country, foreign money, is from China. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not shocking. They're the best. Mm-hmm. And that's how we all see Asians. If I was walking down a street in Harlem or anywhere in the city, and I saw 10 Asian boys coming towards me with baseball bats and chains, I'd be like, oh, I wonder where they're going. And if I saw one...
Man!
If I saw one black guy with a chain and a bat,
really? Man! Wow!
But the thing that I'd like for you to talk about is Walking Dead is one of my favorite shows, and there's an Asian character.
I'm not familiar with Walking Dead. Is that's current?
Seriously? Yeah.
I don't.
Maybe somebody else can. But I have to say, I have just been so impressed with the producers and his character. He's not some weak, not emotional. He fights. He kills.
Don't be.
You know.
Don't be.
I mean you don't see that. You don't see that.
The Asian
guy gets the white girl when the world is over.
Oh.
That's true. That is true, because Asian men are emasculated. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Because what they're showing you is a very sort of like, okay, everything has fallen. Now we're going to
two people on earth.
Never look. But you notice the black characters always get killed.
Right. You know, it's like
repeatedly.
Like that.
Repeatedly.
But that doesn't change.
Anthony, do we have time for one more?
Yeah.
Okay. Professor Sun.
I just want to answer that question. You didn't answer my question, because I get this all the time about the model minority, and I said in some ways it's true. The only thing that it is disadvantaged to is the people that really don't do well.
Yes.
And then you have to, like in City College, everybody, the students would look in the class and say, oh, there are at least half the class is Asian and therefore I'm going to withdraw.
Hell yeah.
Because
oh, that definitely
are good at math, and I'm not going to do well, so I'm going to withdraw. So that's one thing that happens. But you didn't say expressly, how do you deal with the model minority thing? And one other thing that I want to say, that historically, that if you're well and you're good and you're a model minority, that it can be used against you. Because in 1882, when the railroad was finished and the Chinese came out and they came and did all sorts of work, and they were so good at the farming and so forth, that people said, they're taking our jobs away. They're doing things that we can't ever do. And so what they did was they excluded us. Mm-hmm. And so this it can also work against you.
So my response though is I wouldn't agree that only if you're on the lower rung that it's harmful, because there's plenty of cases, and I'm not just saying in research, where students and kids were doing exceptionally well by any measure, and they've taken their own lives or they've made horrible choices. The gentleman at Harvard who was stressed, and Eldo Kim, who called in a bomb threat because he didn't study. I would assume that kid, Eldo, was doing well, and the reports were saying all students at Harvard knew this course, people would get A's or B's, and he had nothing to worry about. But he emailed in a bomb threat because of that placement. So I don't think that, I think the stereotype and beyond, I think the stereotype is harmful for everyone, and not just for Asian people, but for race relations as a whole, even white people. When you have a false understanding of reality, and when, right, I think, I would argue that the stereotype is problematic on all levels and all accounts. But going back to the Chinese railroad, all stereotypes originate somewhere, and right. So when you're talking about they were very good workers, and then they were absolutely excluded. And so that to me smells really fishy in terms of white supremacy. Of you're cool enough, you're good enough for your labor, and then we'll dismiss you. And so right, we'll use you. And so white interest convergence, a CRT principle, I think is always at play. Critical race theory. Think about reparations. Did blacks receive reparations? I don't think so. I think they're still waiting on that. Japanese, did they receive some forms of reparations?
Yes.
Yeah. Why?
But very little.
Very little. Absolutely. They need more. Blacks need more. Right? But white supremacy did that because of that honorary whiteness status, I would argue. And it served a political. Also, when we think about immigration, right? We talk about illegal, undocumented immigrants, right? A lot of the dreamers are Asians. A lot of the dreamers are Asians. So when we think about the face, you're absolutely right. The face of poverty here is black woman on welfare. The face of, despite the statistics of high whites and Asians who are impoverished. I don't want to take any more of the time. I think we're close to time. Anthony, do we have time for any more or questions? A couple more? Okay. Yes, I'm sorry. You've been raising your hand so much.
Thanks. So from two different perspectives, I'm not an academic. I'm a young professional who is trying to launch a chamber of commerce. So I have a lot of interest in what the minority stereotypes kind of play into business world. And I actually led the Asian diversity agenda at Diageo, which is the world's largest alcohol company.
Yes.
And interesting company, right? You've heard of it, Johnny Walker, Smirnoff. And it's interesting to hear this dialogue of, okay, the minorities are not binding together. Okay, the whites are supremacists because they're white. I think that's also equally unfair. And I think just to kind of throw around the word white supremacist is incorrect.
I said white supremacy. But not all whites are supremacists. Oh, you've heard other people say. Okay.
Supremacists.
Oh, white supremacists.
Okay. I don't necessarily think is accurate.
Okay.
And I you asked before what what do we do in New York City?
Yeah.
I think there's actually a lot being done in New York City. I think there's a lot being done in the business world. I think diversity agendas talk about model minority. They talk about, you know, what are your struggles as an Asian American? How do we get you to become a CEO? And they do talk about it. You know, we're scratching the surface. But I think even shows like Fresh Off the Boat bring it into dialogue. And it makes it more normal for people to actually think about Asians. Whereas when you think about Blacks, you have shows like Blackish. I have people, I have so many friends who are equally angry about Blackish. They are with Fresh Off the Boat. Fresh Off the Boat. But nobody here talked about Blackish, right? It's not just an Asian problem. It's not just a specific stereotype problem. It's, you know, there are lots of different stereotypes to tackle. And I think the real course of action is not to just keep talking about it, but, you know, how do we apply it?
Absolutely. And beyond the industries you're citing in the education at the K-12, there are organizations that are doing what you said. For example, Teach for America, they've attempted to launch this Asian program where they recruit heavily Asian American teachers, because we know nationally there's a shortage.
Is the shortage because they can get more money doing something else? Or
well, so that
I'm supposed to be a Spanish teacher, but I went into the corporate world, into insurance. I was like, I don't have parents on my back. I don't have, you know, I can leave my work at work and then go home.
And despite, I think that's I mean, that's a fair enough question. But I think the question too we need to ask is what benefit having Asian American teachers in our classrooms, and if there is barriers to that, then we need to incentivize it and make it worth financially or whatever it takes, right? Because right now, the classroom is very white, very middle class background of the teachers, right? 84% female. And so I would argue, right, that there is a value added to having a diverse, right, to reflect the children that are being taught. Otherwise, it's they're teaching and everyone else is the student. You know?
I think that's the same thing that's happening in the corporate world. And actually, when you made that statement of when three people apply to a finance job, if there's an Asian, a Black, and a white, I actually think the Black gets the job first because of diversity agendas. And there's
actually
so
statistics
much
in the, I work at the EOC, and the African Americans face an enormous amount of discrimination.
Of course they do, but in finance,
still today.
White male could have a felony record. The Black guy could graduate from a top school, and the white male statistically would get a job more likely.
I have to say, at least for my generation, for recruiting efforts, right out of school.
There's research. You're right. There's research that just shows that even an Ivy League degree for a Black man will not help.
I want to follow up on white supremacy for me. For me, my understanding of white supremacy is not about skin color.
Absolutely, it's not. It's not about skin color.
Economic and political control.
You're right.
It is, and white supremacy is bad for white people.
You're right.
And a perfect example is during the 1960s, Martin Luther King, they did not want Black people riding in the front of the bus. And they did not want they didn't want Black people riding in the front of the bus, not because they didn't want Black people riding in front of the bus. They wanted to make white poor people feel special.
You're right.
They needed another social class that they could step on, because the rich whites that controlled the political and economic structure needed a middle buffer to control the situation.
Absolutely.
And so you will find in New York City that 40% of Black men drop out of high school, but you know what? The third bad group is Italians. And so Italians and Irish and ethnic whites are suffering also. It's the white supremacy, is the political and economic control of our system, is the wealth got contracted more and more and more, and it's not going to stand on its own. Occupy Wall Street was about this white generation in America no longer to put up for it. So maybe in the future, you'll get what you're talking about.
I wasn't saying that there was no discrimination.
Sure, sure.
There's clearly discrimination, which is why there needs to be diversity agendas.
Mm-hmm.
But my point was, there is progress. There is something to look forward to.
You're in your 20s?
Right.
And that's the question, and that's the question, though. But that's the question I ask. Is there progress, and how can we measure it? Is it this numerical way, okay, now 40% of CEOs are Asian, or, you know, quantitatively? And I don't know, because, right, I see a progress in some fronts, but I see a lot of retreating in certain areas.
Oh, can I want to point out, you know, the adoption thing that you brought out, just quickly. When you were speaking, it was so fun. Like, there's a reason. The number one minority adoption is an Asian man.
You're absolutely right.
Every person wants one.
Yes, but yes, you're right.
Kids, yeah. You know, black yep. kids have more broken families. 70% of black babies are born outside of marriage. Mm-hmm. And I think for Asians, it's like less than 5%. Mm-hmm. And the only time they have a baby out of wedlock is when the daddy's black.
Sure.
And
sure.
so, we
you're right.
don't, they, you know, there's certain culture that they just, things that they don't do.
The babies, when you look at, yeah, the research on the adoption, you're absolutely right. The babies, white babies cost the most, and then, because you pay, right? And then Asian, and you're right, and lower are blacks and Latinos. Yeah.
And let me say that, like, in terms absolutely. Of African American and Asian community, we have no issues. I don't know if you guys remember, a year ago or 2 years ago, in East Harlem, there was a light-skinned black man who was, robbing Asian people. He must have did like 10 of them before he got caught. And the Hispanic and the black community were in uproar. They were angry about it, they were watching them, you saw black people following Asian women home just to make sure they get home safe. So there was a sense that they're a part of our community, and we were angry by their being targeted, and we embraced them.
But there were, I mean, I would say, I want to say it's kumbaya. I think we have issue, the black community and Asian/American, I mean, in Ferguson, I mean, all across, I mean, we can cite these anecdotal.
In California.
Yeah.
In New York, the reason why blacks don't look at Asians with such anger is because in New York, Asians are not the landlords. The Jewish community owns more than 80% of the real estate in black and Latino communities, so they're the boogeyman in the black and Latino community. Asians, and, you know, 20, 30 years ago when Dinkins was mayor, they might have owned the fruit stands, the grocery stores, but they got out of the hood and they were replaced by the Arabs. And the only time you see Asians is in Midtown or in the nice white areas. But they're not in our communities anymore in any significant number. So there's no tension. And the only way they're in our community is providing us food. And we love them.
Well, I mean, I think there's tension all amongst all the races. I mean, what? No, I'll be honest, right? So Silicon Valley, the new white flight.
But Asians are not in the black community.
Population, too many Asians, we're going to move, right? We're not going to compete, right? Right. So when there's limited resources and there's competition, right? Ethnic groups, racial groups, cultural groups will do what's in their best interest to, right, to negotiate those realities. And, right, and then, right, white supremacy, I use that term broadly, the state enacts policies that benefit, right? So no longer we're going colorblind. Affirmative action does no longer exist. Or now this group is eligible, it's not. Or now we're doing percentage plans. So if you get this, the top 10 gets the direct admit. I mean, it's constantly changing. But the constant that I read as critical race theorists is racism. And so that racism was present, right, with the railroad workers. It's present now. And I would say, you know, it's going to be present in the future. The question, right, because Asians weren't the first model minorities. Jews were in the U.S., and now it's shifting. Who's going to be the next model minority? We don't know. Only time will tell.
They were not the model minority in the black community, so that's new to us.
Jews?
Yeah. They've over the tension has always been real and bitter. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They've never been the modern minority.
Especially the Hasidim
and Crown Heights. Especially. And you were right. This will always exist because white supremacy can only rule through conquer and division.
Yeah.
Divide and conquer. That is the only way. So
and that's where I'm going with this, right, with what you said. I think no one benefits from this. Mm-hmm. I mean, because what Professor Sung said about the displacement, right, the poor whites, right, the rednecks, where we get the term, they were trying to, like you described, right, it's like, well, you don't want to be them, so join us. So until we really understand that, I don't think progress can be made. But I'm glad to hear that New York is doing some work in these regards. Yeah.
So it's not so much a racial issue. I mean, if the, not so much the supremacists, but the ones controlling the power are also subjugating their own, but the lower class, then it's not so much a matter of race, but or ethnicity, but it's about just economic power.
Yeah.
If they want to subjugate They want to subjugate everyone else.
But class and race, they correlate highly, right? Because of our history, I mean, right? We need intersectional. We need to see, right, that race and class connect in certain ways, right? That one's not the best predictor, but they're very close, right? We talk about gender disparities, and I had a slide that I use sometimes that show actually return on education. Asians receive lower return on education, and then you can see the gender effect of the same education. A PhD, the white person will have more money and all of that. But yeah, this country was built on slavery and free labor for how many years? And that, you know, with interest, compound interest, you can't catch up in that game, can you? But you're right, the business world has caught wind. I mean, that we as Asian Americans represent a huge, vastly growing population with a lot of capital to spend. And so you should start advertising to them. They should buy the Kia, they should buy the Toyota and the Honda, right?
It's huge. And how they decide where to put their marketing money. And it's all towards minorities. It's towards gays, it's towards Asians, it's towards women specifically, which is crazy because we're 50% of the population.
I really encourage you, it's on YouTube, Space Traders. If you haven't seen that video, it's about 30-minute clip. It's Derek Bell's notion of white interest convergence, and in the 80s, right? So this movie, it was run through HBO. It's accessible. Space Traders, and it goes how the powers to be make these decisions of the business leaders. There's alien space traders come and they say, we'll take all of your black people up to space, and in return, we'll give you all the gold you want. We'll clean all the air, and all that. And then the president and all the other cabinet members and municipal aldermen and gun owners and liquor and tobacco, they talk and they're like, well, what happens if all the blacks go? Well, blacks drink how much cognac? And this, well, we would lose revenue there. And if we sent the blacks there, and well, we don't know. Maybe it's great up there. Who says it's, you know, bad up there? We don't know. So maybe we should be. And all of the kind of thought process, right? And it goes, I think it really captures what we're discussing here of interests and who benefits by it. It's very fascinating. I really encourage you. Space Traders is what it's called. 30 minutes.
What she's talking about is critical because that's where they identify ethnic group, and you don't want to get where we are, because African Americans are the highest market participant for all nonsense. We have the lowest savings rate. We are the poorest in America, and Asians have the highest savings rate.
But why is that?
Because of corporations and because a whole host of social issues. But
sure,
you know, we wear our wealth instead of being more wise. I have to tell you another bias that I had towards about Asian. I learned. I was 20. I grew up addicted to heroin. You know, I'm a 46-year-old. I've been drug free for 46 years in the womb. So I was born addicted to heroin. And I have to tell you, at 20 years old, I bought a co-op. And the reason I bought a co-op after I left the group home was because of a girlfriend who was Asian, and who just said, "This is how my family. This is how we are. What we are." And I learned the importance of savings. So from 14 years old to 21 years old, I saved my money and bought a co-op in the Bronx. And it was because of those Asian stereotypical values of hard work, savings, no materialism. I didn't wear fancy sneakers, and it has done me well. And so even as an adult, I had no major debt, and financially, I don't have any financial pressure because of those values. So I'm not. Your company, I'm the worst person to have in your bar, and I've owned 3 bars. You don't want me in your bar because I'll buy one drink. Unless I'm with a woman, I don't drink.
You know, and I think, I mean, well, one, you know, that's wonderful that you've been doing all that. So that's great. You know, I don't think that whites, you know, they were more frugal and blacks were just, like you're saying, just made all these poor decisions. I think there's many reasons and causes, like you've said you agreed with, that can explain, right, for home ownership, Levittown. How did that create? How did the government give FHA back loans to certain groups and bar out, right? Redlining, gentrification. I mean, gentrification, right? New York, of all places, right? You know what gentrification is. So I think that my only problem with, by just saying this narrative of like, well, we have to save more and all of that, is it kind of absolves white supremacy and those policy things. Like, there is no level playing field that can be used to explain why wealth accumulation here and why Asians are doing well and blacks. So simply, there's a host, a myriad of reasons that can explain what we're seeing. And I also wouldn't agree with saying with, right, you don't want to become us. We have to understand we're on both the same side. We're both staring racism in our eye, right?
I'd rather complain about the $1 million bonus than complain about 90% of us being Rikers.
Sure, but your colleague was a black man, didn't you say? Yeah.
What I mean is, okay. I'd rather have people say, you sure. know, you blacks are so doomed as a 70% of Stuyvesant.
I don't think you would want that either. I don't think you want to be the billionaire. I mean, I think we want equity. Right. I think we all want equity. The minimum wage and
I mean, the fight against stereotype and racism is for every individual to be a human that they
absolutely
want to be without any strictures or any
absolutely.
Sort of preconceived notions. That's
absolutely.
The thing, right? Exchanging one set of chains for another
right.
under the same king is no freedom. That's a different type of freedom. Mm-hmm. Less terrible.
And that's what white males are going through. They're suffering because of white supremacy. You talk to white parents, they say, no, I want my child to go to diverse school because I don't want my son growing up not knowing, having black or minority friends, because he can't relate when he gets to corporate America. He gets on a bus and starts singing, no niggas here, blah, blah, blah.
Oh, the, yeah.
Yeah. So that's, you know, that white supremacy hurts white people. And that
absolutely.
That white student who said that on the bus, that's a perfect example. He has a false sense of superiority.
Mm-hmm.
And the future is getting better, and he's not going to have the protections.
And we don't, as Asian people, we don't want a false sense of superiority and say, oh yeah, we're the model minorities, we embrace that, bulk up our chest. Absolutely not. We have to understand, right, there's a comparison, and that comparative group, like the gentleman said too, can become, if we look at, you know, then it becomes, right, the Southeast Asian, Hmong, Cambodian, certain people, we can otherize that, and that's problematic as well. So we really need to humanize one another through that process.
What you said is critical. I'm running for city council in a couple of years in Manhattan, so all I'm doing is raising money. And I have a contributor, white contributor, a lawyer, and her grandfather owned property in Upper Manhattan. He was a slumlord. They have a huge trust fund. And she's enormous guilt she's living with because she knows, because gentrification is here now in New York City. And there's this enormous guilt that she's living with because she knows this money comes from blood. At the same time, she's a lawyer, husband's PhD, professor. Both kids have not graduated from college because the money has corrupted them. It is white supremacy has killed her kids, that sense of luxury. And that's the poison of it.
Absolutely.
I know tons of Asian families. That are
old money.
Same
poison. Yeah.
Yeah, but that's also a class issue.
Yeah.
Right, but I don't think it's like a white issue.
No, but it's not a black issue because we don't have the income. So you're absolutely right, but from the black perspective, that's a problem we would love to have.
I'm really, as a young man too, I'm really interested in young people, myself included, and there's a lot of research that shows that I'm worried for my generation, even in young folk of race, because the young folk, there's a lot of research coming out that really shows that they believe, and myself included, that we're progressive, we're radical, we're right, but in fact, it's implicitly very racist, very closet, and really have a hard time to articulate that. We use codified language. That's another point that I guess I'd like to close tonight by sharing. My reading of the stereotype is, right, the substitution of racial markers for culture. So we say, oh, you know, their culture, Confucian culture, parenting, and that explains it, and, you know, So we talk nasty about Asians by actually endorsing the model minority stereotype. Because no longer are you a human being. No longer are you an artist or someone who hates school. You are this. And whenever we really essentialize someone, that really removes you of your humanity and very limits you. And so I do see, I'm worried for younger people who, because, right, that's really dangerous. Like, it's one thing if you're sick and you know you're sick, okay, give me some medicine to help. It's another if you think you're fine and you're actually sick. And what I mean by sick is you have these issues of racism that you're not understanding. But yeah.
So you're referring to colorblindness.
Colorblindness, post-racialism, but even beyond that is, I mean, Eduardo Bonilla Silva, his work on racism without racist and colorblind racism is how the semantic moves we use, right? Like, oh, I have an Asian friend, right? Or I'm not racist, but, well, I know you said that. I think you're coming from a racist positionality.
Yeah, I do want to clarify something that when people think that Asians are doing well, they're rich, etc., etc. Just a few years back, you know, the Center for Equal Opportunities came up with a study that showed New York City Asians, you know, after you take in all the other, you know, this, you don't just look at household income. You can take in into other benefits and stuff, taking everything into account. It will show that Asians in New York City actually are doing poorer than African or Hispanic Americans.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that people don't normally see. And if you go to the Asian community, there are some who are very successful, you know, doing well, you know, graduate Ivy schools and stuff like that. But there's also a lot of language disadvantage immigrants who cannot find a job, or who stuck in a low income job with no advancement, or if they are doing their own business. They are barely surviving. And you have seen a lot of those. You know, like Korean Americans are the most entrepreneurial, in terms of statistics, the largest percentage among Asian Americans, Korean Americans are small business. But however, if you look at them, a lot of them, they don't even afford medical insurance.
Mm-hmm.
They don't even have that.
Mm-hmm.
They're just barely passing by. So I think this idea that somehow Asians are successful or they are doing well, that's actually not true. Mm-hmm. And it's doing more damage than help.
Is it because of family?
Thanks for sharing that.
Because of their commitment to take care of their seniors?
For
Asians, like in the African American community, that's my understanding of Asians, the family stays together, the parents stay together, and that my Asian friends that are older my age, their parents live with us.
Well, there's a lot of reasons. There's a lot of health issues with the Asian community in terms of wellness checkups and also coverage. Like you said, there's a large percentage underinsured or uninsured, and then when you have these medical when you haven't had preventative care, right, then the cancer's caught late, or the health is also, the belief in Western medicine and those considerations. Thank you for sharing that, because those are definitely, I think of, you're right, the face that society has of Asians is, one, East Asian. And then second, beyond the whole cultural markers of chopsticks and rice and fortune cookies, which Asian people didn't make up fortune cookies, is, right, success. And Harold Koh, who's much older than I, but Korean, I cite him because his surname is Koh, and that's my Korean surname, Koh, wrote a law article in which actually was the article took form of his speech, and he gave this speech of, well, what does us going to Yale Law School, how is that success if it doesn't translate to other things? What about family satisfaction? What about loved ones? What about being accepted in society. To me, it only means that I've been successful at getting into Yale Law School. And so I think beyond educational attainment and money, we need to look at other markers of what is success. Because I've read studies of happiness and that show, right, that arguably you might have all the success in the world, but you're unhappy. To me, that's not success, right? Success is if you're successful in whatever you're calling it and you're happy about it. No one would want to be successful and unhappy. At least I don't. I don't think that makes rational sense. So I think it's really important to consider other things. I mean, disaggregation of all these arguments that we need to see these things, those obviously are important. We need to see these subgroups so we can make comparisons. But in terms of success, you know, I don't want that label if it means that my other brothers and sisters, I use that metaphorically, are being oppressed in a society that does that, right? And I don't really comply with all of those stereotypes because I'm loud, I cuss, I'm young, and right, I don't give a shit. Right? And so, you know, even my students, many of my students at the university are white girls studying to be a teacher. And they're like, what? It's like this cognitive dissonance. Like, what? You're supposed to be meek and do it. I'm like, no. Sit down. Like, raise my voice. Right? I have an anger, you know? But so, I'd like to thank everyone for coming out tonight. Really appreciate it. I learned so much from you. Thanks.